On this episode of the All American Legacy Podcast, the incredible story of the paratroopers who invaded Sicily during the first large airborne invasion in American history.
Somebody started opening fire. They fired up in the air, and we all did. We just unloaded our rifles and fired up in the air. Couldn't see anything but assuming that they were these German paratroopers that were coming down. Well, whenever it broke daylight, we got late daylight, we looked around in those olive trees, and we saw some people from the 504 Parachute Regiment. They were part of the 82nd Airborne. We were shooting down our own men.
A couple of the boys got killed. A couple of them landed on some of these cactus trees that they had there with long spear leaves that went right through their bodies, and there was nothing we could do about saving them. That was the indoctrination to death.
Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. Glory, glory, what a hell of a way to die. And he ain't gonna jump no more. Is everybody happy? Cried the sergeant looking up. Our hero meekly answered yes, and then they stood him up. He leaped right out into the blast, his static line unhooked, and he ain't gonna jump no more.
Welcome back to the All-American Legacy Podcast. This is Lieutenant Colonel Joe Bacino. That was Blood on the Risers by the All-American Chorus. Today, we're talking about the 82nd Airborne Division's parachute assault into Sicily during World War II. Codenamed Operation Husky. This is episode 10, Fire in the Sky. A little bit of a different format today. For today's show, I am the one answering the questions rather than asking them. I was interviewed by Angus Wallace for this episode. Angus is a British World War II historian and the host of World War II Pod. He's been featured on the History Network, and he spent a lot of time covering Operation Husky, but never from the perspective of the airborne insertion. So what we're talking about today is the division's first airborne assault and the first major combat airborne operation in American history. We should explain the title. We always try to go with an attention-grabbing title, and today's show is Fire in the Sky, which is a reference to the friendly fire incident we will talk about here. Many paratroopers and the pilots carrying them were shot down over Gela, the Sicilian beach on the Mediterranean coast. And one of the other things we talk about here is the training that Ridgway had the All-American paratroopers do in North Africa. The division moved to North Africa to prepare for the airborne assault into Sicily, and they trained on airborne operations. We spoke with Bob Miller, a private first class with the 505th Parachute Infantry Regiment during Operation Husky, and he talked to us a little bit about some of the training. Here is a story he had to tell us about the training that they did in North Africa.
Well, at that time, I was at PFC, and we bounced around. They gave us 2 days to get acclimated and everything else, the heat of the desert and the cold of the nights. And then we started training. I think we did three practice jumps 2 weeks before it started. We had some casualties on the jump. A couple of the boys got killed. A couple of them landed on some of these cactus trees that they had there with long spear leaves that went right through their bodies, and there was nothing we could do about saving them. That was the indoctrination to death. And of course, you looked at it and you shrugged. You said, well, there for the grace of God go I. And that was it.
Here is some newsreel footage from late in 1943 highlighting the division's participation in Operation Husky.
They were to drop into Sicily behind enemy lines, ahead of an Allied invasion that was coming in by sea.
So just to set this up, at this point in the war, General Eisenhower was looking for a way to insert the Allies into Fortress Europe, and the airborne assault into Sicily was a big part of that. Operation Husky was a critical moment in the life of the 82nd Airborne Division. This is the first time our Army did this. This large airborne operation went horribly wrong, and after Husky, Eisenhower almost scrapped the whole idea of the Airborne Division. So Angus and I get into that in some detail. We also talk about what saved the 82nd as an airborne division. And with that set up, let's go right to my discussion with Angus Wallace.
If we're looking at the 82nd airborne element of Husky, it's probably worth looking at the 82nd themselves.
Mm. Yeah.
They were only recently designated airborne.
Right. Yeah. Entering into World War II, this was a new thing.
So Husky was going to be the first really large scale drop for them. But just prior to that, there was some drops at Torch, wasn't there? How had they gone? Was anything drawn out from that?
Nothing was too drawn out. It was such a small operation, and it was so insignificant to the success at Torch that there was no real there was nothing that really could be applied to something on the scale of Husky. There was a battalion in Operation Torch in North Africa. There was a battalion, the 509th Parachute Infantry Battalion, that participated. That was the first parachute assault in U.S. history.
So when they decide to go into Sicily and Husky, why did they feel they needed the airborne? What was their initial objectives?
The 82nd would be part of a massive airborne assault the night before, the night of the 9th, 9 July, and reinforce the 1st Infantry Division, really set the conditions for the 1st Infantry Divisions in the Jela sector by cutting lines of communication and disrupting routes for the Italian forces and for what turned out to be the Hermann Göring Division, although the 82nd did not know that the Italian forces were reinforced by the Hermann Göring Division. And then later they were to effect link up with General Terry De La Mesa's 1st Infantry Division at the Ponte Oliva airfield. So those were, in a broad sense, the objectives for the 82nd Airborne Division. What General Patton and General Eisenhower hoped that the 82nd would do was really just slow down the ground forces there in Sicily for the 1st Infantry Division. And by and large, the 82nd actually did, despite all the problems with getting getting to the objective and getting on the ground.
Yeah. Well, getting on the ground is actually their first thing they had to get over. And something that had never occurred to me was the availability of aircraft being a problem to get so many on the ground, with the British also fighting for aircraft, because the 82nd, I think, were almost cut out of the operation and sent to be used as a reserve fighting with the British.
Yeah, most of the division actually was used as reserve, but yeah, they were almost cut out, and they were sort of an afterthought when in terms of allocating aircraft. So they had to reduce, General Ridgway, the commander of the 82nd, had to reduce the number of paratroopers committed to Sicily because there just were not enough aircraft to go around.
When we talk about the aircraft, I mean, they weren't permanently designated for this use. I mean, how much cooperation between the airborne troops and the troop carrier pilots and the whole of that organization was put in place before? Had they practiced? Do they come as a package?
They practiced more than we think. So the 52nd troop carrier wing was scheduled to carry the 82nd from North Africa to Sicily, and they had trained together at Fort Bragg. But during that training, General Ridgway noted that the 52nd Troop Carrier Wing is not capable of conducting night operations. He was concerned about that. That concern kind of went unheeded. And he did make that known to both Eisenhower and Patton before 9 July 1943, but the decision was made to go through with the night drop anyway, largely at the time. I think in understanding some of these decisions, we've got to understand that there was a greater willingness to accept casualties than you will ever see in any current day operation.
Yes, well, that's true. So did they train at all for night drops once they knew it was on the cards?
really they had no real way to train this kind of operation at night. So they just had no way to replicate it.
I hadn't realized that. I presumed that they trained quite a lot for it, because it somehow seems obvious that you would use them at night. Sort of really does sort of explain things somewhat.
Well, so they did that. They in North Africa, the division did two regimental sized jumps. Those were problematic, you know, and they never replicated the full conditions of Sicily. But even those were problematic. You know, the pilots in some of those cases dropped the paratroopers at the wrong drop zone. Leading into Sicily, I think, leading into Operation Husky, it was clear that there were going to be some problems.
Had they done anything to prepare people for being misdropped?
They did. The 82nd did, yes. So one of the reasons that the 82nd was selected, the 82nd Division was selected for this airborne capability was because of General Ridgway. General Ridgway and Omar Bradley. And so they had prepared the division to operate in small groups, and you saw that in Sicily, that if they just got onto the ground, if they got to the drop zone, they could find one another, and they could, you know, as General Patton said, they could wreak havoc. Or I think, you know, one of the Italian officers said they would introduce mischief. So. You know, we call that in today's vernacular, we call that friction, introduce friction into the battlefield. And if you can introduce friction, you can slow things down. They slowed down the Hermann Göring division in Sicily. All things being equal, whoever overcomes friction the best and the quickest is going to have, likely to have more success.
From Strike and Hold, a memoir of the 82nd Airborne in World War II. By All-American paratrooper T. Moffett Burris. Despite the fact that many of us landed many miles from the drop zone, the invasion proved the wisdom of our paratrooper training. From the beginning, we were taught to fight in small groups and behind enemy lines. Our purpose was to disrupt communication lines, divert the enemy's attention, and create general havoc in areas where we were least expected to be. When we were isolated from the main force, we didn't panic. We regrouped in twos and threes, then proceeded to seek out and attack the enemy. Avoiding superior forces that might have overwhelmed us, we nonetheless fought aggressively and killed many times our own numbers. We didn't fight by the book or wait to receive orders from headquarters. In an atypical situation, we improvised, as we'd been taught to do.
What problems did they have? How did they get on?
Well, you know, so 9 July... The evening of 9 July was when they departed North Africa for Sicily. And right before, you know, this is in Gavin's diary, General Gavin's diary, Colonel Jim Gavin at the time, in his diary, that right before the door closed on his aircraft, somebody stuck their head in and said, "We've got 35-mile-an-hour winds east to west." So you would never conduct an airborne operation in those conditions today. You know, he prepared for hard landing, but once the aircraft took off, you know, that wreaked havoc on the pilot's ability to calculate time and distance, because they calculated those things based on, they calculated how far they were based on how long they were flying. And so they were, you know, flying, they were moving at a slower distance because of the wind was pushing them. And so the other problem was the sun started to set as they kind of were in the air. You know, you couldn't see the tip of the wings of the aircraft in front of you. You couldn't see the aircraft at all. So they were broken up into smaller groups. One of the identifying terrain features was Malta. Some of them didn't quite know they were over Malta. Some of them mistook Sicily for Malta. There was kind of just mass confusion. You know, on 10 July at 0245 is when the main amphibious assault was scheduled to go. So we, the 82nd Airborne Division, was to drop ahead of that time. So they got scattered everywhere. You know, Gavin really had no idea where he was. And then, you know, the other thing was that a lot of them were dropped onto hard terrain, so they were injured or they were killed on the landing. And once they got there, they were, you know, they were scattered everywhere. You know, they'd been blown off course by the winds, so even the ones that were dropped over the right drop zone, they were blown further off of the drop zone. It was chaotic. But to their ultimate credit, you know, they operated in what's known as little groups of paratroopers. They arrived in the drop zone. They found one another. They found other paratroopers, even those that were not, they had not directly trained with. And they started to cut communication lines. They started to find the tanks of the Hermann Göring Division. They began to find the soldiers of the Hermann Göring Division. They took high ground. You know, they slowed things down, certainly, for the Germans and the Italian forces. They slowed the German Italian forces down.
It's where Gavin marched into the sound of gunfire because he had no idea where he was himself.
Right, he had no idea where he was himself, and he did not know that the Germans had reinforced Sicily with the Hermann Göring Division. Yeah, so he marched to the sound of the guns, and he had six people with him, so he kind of took six people, the six people he found, and they just started to introduce friction.
When day broke, he did manage to find more of his own people, and this pulled together a scratch force.
Right. Yeah, as the day of 10 July wore on, they gathered into larger and larger forces and actually began to secure the objectives that that they were sent to secure. You know, one of the things Colonel Gavin is—he was the commander of the 505th Parachute Infantry Regiment. And before, on the night of 9 July, when the paratroopers were getting ready to board the aircraft, they each received a letter, a mimeographed message from Colonel Gavin. And we refer to this message here a lot because it does speak to the legacy and the culture.
Soldiers of the 505th Command Team, tonight you embark upon a combat mission for which our people and the free people of the world have been waiting for 2 years. You'll spearhead the landing of an American force upon the island of Sicily. The eyes of the world are upon you. The hopes and prayers of every American go with you. Since it's our first fight at night, you must use the countersign and avoid firing on each other. The bayonet is the night fighter's best weapon. Conserve your water and ammunition. The term American parachutist has become synonymous with courage of a high order. Let us carry the fight to the enemy and make the American parachutist feared and respected through all his ranks. Attack violently. Destroy him everywhere found. I know you'll do your job. Good landing, good fight, and good luck.
So they did that, certainly, and that's been, I think, the sort of the clarion call of this division ever since. You know, that's been the guiding philosophy of this division ever since. If you look at the other operations we participated in and the way the Global Response Force that we have today in the 82nd is postured, those things really harken back to this notion of this really romantic notion of courage from Colonel Gavin.
Well, you just have to look what he did on the day at, is it Biaza Ridge?
You know, Biaza Ridge is one of, is really part of our, a big part of our legacy here. You know, there's a road here in Fort Bragg that's named after it. So, you know, what one of the stories that is told from that night is the story of Private Reed Satterstrom. Gavin's orders were everyone's going to jump unless they'd already died. You know, everybody's going to jump. Everybody gets off the aircraft. Nobody returns to North Africa with the aircraft. So Private Reed Satterstrom, his snap hook would not open. You know, so his static line that opens the chute, the snap hook wouldn't open. So he handed the static line to the plane crew chief as on his way out and says, whatever you do, hold on to this. The crew chief braced himself against the bulkhead and Satterstrom went out. He's holding the reserve. His hand was on the reserve the whole time. To his ultimate credit, the crew chief held on to the static line. The guy's chute opened. It's quite a story. I didn't necessarily believe that story when I first heard it, but it's recounted in three different places, and there were two other paratroopers who witnessed it and documented it.
That is a great story of just getting on the ground. They drop these poor buggers in, and they think they're going to be facing one thing, and then suddenly you've got the Hermann Göring Division.
Right. Although, you know, the Hermann Göring Division was sort of an economy of force. The Hermann Göring Division was under strength and was not a very well-trained organization, quite frankly. So that should be understood in the process of understanding. But they did have tanks. They had Tiger tanks. And so that was a surprise to the All-American Division.
Yeah, and they're issued with bazookas, which were bouncing off them.
Yeah, they were fitted with bazookas. So the 82nd were fitted with bazookas, and the problem is that to kill a Tiger tank, you had to get it from the right angle. Colonel Gavin, the 505th commander, he in the morning in sunlight, he found a lot of the airborne paratroopers and their bazookas were crushed by tank tracks.
Frightening, isn't it?
When you think about the modern combat, I mean, it's an odd thing to think that, you know, we asked people to do something that had a very small chance to succeed.
Some did land according to plan. I mean, how well did they manage to achieve their objective? I mean, I guess ultimately they held out as the bridgehead was secured and the infantry came ashore. But for those who landed, I mean, I guess if you've got an objective, if you've got an objective to take and most of your men don't turn up to take it, did they carry on and manage to achieve the objectives, those objectives that they were given?
Yeah, they did. You know, the Italians thought that, some of the Italians thought that there were three airborne infantry divisions that, so they saw so many of them. They saw so much activity, so much movement, so much disruption of lines of communication. One of the historical arguments that comes out of this is, would the invasion of Sicily been an Allied success were it not for the 82nd Airborne Division? I think history tells us that it would have. It actually would have. And in fact, that's actually, there's no question about that. It would have. However, the 1st Infantry Division would have taken more casualties. Historically, the question, or not even historically, but immediately in the aftermath, the question was it worth it? You know, we took such a high casualty rate on these airborne forces that was it worth it? And then the question for the Allies and for Eisenhower was, is it worth it to maintain this capability? Should we even keep this division as an airborne division, or should we revert back to, should we just make them an infantry division?
You very much was an experiment. And I kind of wonder at the end of it all, and we haven't even touched on the fact, you know, there's a second wave that came in that was almost worse than the first wave. 23 planes crashed, 60 seriously hit.
It was worse than the first wave, yeah. So...
because they got hit by friendly fire.
Yeah. So another thing, we talked about Ridgway being concerned about the inability of the pilots to fly at night. But one of the things he said in I guess it would have been in June of 1943, was that the Allied naval commanders wouldn't accept. He had strict fire control measures that he felt were necessary to do a large airborne invasion. The Allied naval commanders would not accept that. He brought that as well to the attention of Eisenhower and Patton. On the first drop, on the night of the 9th and the 10th, you know, night of the 9th, morning of the 10th, that route stayed away from the naval convoys. So there was no real risk of friendly fire. But the 11 July, which was actually the third of three movements for the 82nd, that flew over the naval convoys that had been bombarded. In June, Eisenhower made the naval Allied commanders aware of this, that there was, you know, there was an airborne component to this operation. But that was really just about it. They kind of made everyone aware, and they didn't really implement the kind of fire control measures that Ridgway was looking for. You know, the night of the 11th, July 11th, there were a series of air raids. The gunners were jumpy. According to Patton's diary, this is at least according to his diary. I don't know if it's true. It's at least according to his diary. He tried to call off the jumps, the airborne insertion of 11 July 1943, because he was concerned about the possibility of friendly fire, catastrophic friendly fire. So there were a couple of things there that, first of all, the Allies, as I said, the Allied naval crews were receiving fire. They were jumpy. But the smoke from those firefights was distracting the air crews, so they had to climb even higher. So, you know, they've got to climb higher than normal. The naval crews couldn't tell, you know, what they were. They couldn't identify them. And then once one gun opened, all the others did.
I want to play a clip here from World War II veteran Guy Prestia. Guy Prestia fought in Sicily, but he was never an 82nd Airborne Division paratrooper. Guy Prestia shot down 82nd Airborne Division paratroopers. Prestia was an automatic rifle gunner with the 45th Infantry Division, He was on board the USS Thomas Jefferson on the night of Operation Husky. So here is his story.
We kept getting alert signs, you know, look out for German paratroopers because they might be jumping and we might be getting attacked, you know, by the parachuters. So anyway, we heard planes flying overhead and it was foggy. It was so foggy from the storm that you couldn't even see your hand in front of your face. But we didn't know anything about the planes. Later on, we understood what the German planes were by the sound of the motor, and we could detect them. But we were new in combat. This was when we landed in Sicily, we were the first American soldiers to hit European soil. So we didn't know what planes were flying over. So, but we got that alert to look out for German paratroopers. So someplace around there, somebody started opening fire. They fired up in the air, and we all did. We just unloaded our rifles and fired up in the air. Couldn't see anything, but assuming that they were these German paratroopers that were coming down. Well, whenever it broke daylight, we got late daylight, we looked around in those olive trees, and we saw some people from the 504 Parachute Regiment. They were part of the 82nd Airborne. We were shooting down our own men.
You know, there was a pilot from the 52nd Troop Carrier Wing. He said the next day, he said, evidently the safest place for us last night while over Sicily would have been over enemy territory. I mean, I think it's really significant. It's not really talked about too much, but that our Deputy Division Commander, Brigadier General Charles L. Kearns Jr., the assistant commander of the division, he was lost at sea. He was on one of the aircraft that was lost at sea. His body was never found.
Where was Matthew Ridgway? Did he jump?
General Ridgway, the commander of the 82nd, did not jump into Sicily. He observed the airborne assault at sea from a ship at sea. He positioned himself with Patton in a place to observe the landings. This was still largely an experiment, so this was the first time we'd done this, and Ridgway wanted to observe the integration of airborne forces into an invasion. The best place to do that here was from the sea with the command structure. It's important to note that Ridgway would later jump in on D-Day, and he did lead his soldiers from the ground, from the front, for the rest of the war.
There's still a level of behind the front, though, when they're leading from the... All right, Gavin, what was he at the time, a colonel? You know, that's very much more his job to be in the front line. It's not necessarily the general's job to be there directly with the bullets whizzing round him.
Right. Yeah, there's an element of risk associated with that kind of command leadership and that kind of direction. They really had developed a reputation for being courageous and leading in this way. You know, they were tough, aggressive, competent leaders, and they were exposed to enemy fire as much as anyone. The same, you know, Ridgway, Gavin, Colonel Tucker, the regimental commander, they really earned their troopers' respect and also inspired them with their courage. So,
I mean, I can't think of many other units where your most senior officer would be so far. Well, essentially, they're behind enemy lines,
right,
of that rank,
right. And you know, these stories, the stories like that, and that's one of the reasons that Gavin's legend took off so quickly, and he was promoted so quickly, is that the tales of his reputation within the ranks of the 82nd were forged very quickly and passed. You know, within this relatively small, at this point, cohesive unit. Getting to the objective, it's just a way of putting combat power on the ground very quickly. It's getting to where you're supposed to be with the people you're supposed to be with and doing what you're supposed to do. And if you're not, if you're on the wrong part of Sicily, or if you're not on Sicily, you can't do that. You know, you can't do that. Or it's very hard to do. So a lot of them did other things. They just said, well, we're here. I think we're on Sicily. I think those are Axis forces. We're going to disrupt. We're going to do something. So it was chaos the entire, you know, throughout. It was chaos the entire time. And there were just a lot of lessons learned. You know, the gunners certainly needed better preparation and aircraft identification. They didn't really have that. But the pilots needed more practice in night flying formations. there was no mechanism to mark the drop zones over Husky. So some of these improvements were made following Operation Husky. But
well, I was going to say, you know, when Matthew is saying on D-Day plus three of Husky, you know, he reports the baton 5,000 troops dropped to unit commander 400. You need to start learning some lessons because it's not necessarily the best use of what's available. Though, as you point out, they caused a lot of disruption. How did they improve, getting people to the right spot for, I guess the next drop would be D-Day. I mean, how much had changed between Husky and D-Day?
Well, Salerno was the next drop. For Salerno, the drop zones were marked. So coming out of Husky, I think the biggest application for the rest of the war was the development of pathfinders that would mark the drop zone. And so in Salerno, the drop zones were marked with oil cans. The air crews were trained better in terms of how to get them to the drop zone. In Salerno, Salerno was an early evening, kind of a dusk drop rather than late at night. But the truth is that for the Allies, despite the fact that they took a tremendous amount of casualties, the 82nd did disrupt the enemy. And so if they could continue to do that, it might be worth it. You know, the argument was for the Allies were, and for Eisenhower, we're running out of soldiers at this point in the war. You know, we have here the after action review. It stays here. We have a copy of it here, the hard copy, one of the original hard copies, in the division, the after action review from the War Department, and 5 points of failure were identified. The first was a lack of prior joint coordination. And I think what that really speaks to is a training between the Navy, the air crews, and the 82nd Airborne Division. And these, strict fire control measures, stricter training for the naval crews, and a greater coordination between the ground and the 52nd troop carrier wing. The second was the confusion on behalf of the pilots. You know, they got lost. The winds, the darkness, navigation, trying to navigate by identifying terrain features that they got confused. All those contributed to number two. And then third, there was no pathfinders, nothing marking the drop zone. And then the fourth were just the incredibly unfortunate circumstance of an enemy bombing raid coinciding with the arrival of the troop carrier elements on the 11th. Nothing you can do about
friendly
that.
Friendly fire.
Right, friendly fire. And then fifth, really negligence by some of the ground commanders who failed to warn their units that friendly aircraft were inbound.
It's interesting. None of those are criticism directly of the 82nd Airborne and what they did.
Right.
It's all about really getting them there and getting them to where they needed to be and where that went wrong. There is no criticism whatsoever of their performance on the ground.
Well, it's incredible that they had so much success on the ground despite operating in such small groups and despite all of this confusion. You know, one of the things that is noted in the after action report is that on the night 11, fortunately, a lot of the paratroopers were already hooked up. They were hooked up and in the door. The door was open when their plane was hit, so they just jumped. Only 6 planes were shot down with a full complement of paratroopers in them. So for the most part, these planes were hit and then the paratroopers jumped. In some cases, these planes had already released the paratroopers, but that was a lesson learned going forward, is that as soon as they come over any Allied naval ships, they would hook up in the door. So
just in case.
If we're going to lose 1/3 of our combat power on these airborne drops, should we continue to do it? And so they felt that, Ridgway was committed to it. He was committed to the airborne division, the airborne concept. He just felt we had to tweak these things. We had to train these things better, and that this could continue to give us an advantage, as we pushed into the European theater. Really, Ridgway really had to convince Eisenhower. And so in September 1943, Eisenhower wrote a letter to Marshall where he said, a quote is, "I do not believe in the airborne division." And so I think historically we think there's emphasis on the word division, that he believed that you could do this in smaller groups with smaller units, but that at the division size, you lose the ability to command and control. You assume too much risk. It's too much chaos. All the things we saw manifest in Sicily. The War Department took a critical look. You know, Eisenhower had the War Department take a really critical look at this. Two things came out of the mishaps here at Sicily. One was training circular 113, which is a more refined, robust doctrine of airborne and troop carrier forces and the application thereof. And the second was in December of 1943 was the Knollwood maneuvers. And the Knollwood maneuvers were really a proof of principle of the employment of an airborne division using training circular 113. It was a pretty big training operation called the Knollwood maneuvers because the goal was to capture the Knollwood airport, which is now known as the Moore County Airport here in North Carolina. And it was a 6-day operation with hundreds of paratroopers taking off from 5 separate airfields. There was Pope Army Airfield, which is here, which is now Fort Bragg, Pope Airfield and Fort Bragg, and then others across the United States. And the aircraft met over the Atlantic Ocean and then dropped paratroopers from the 11th Airborne Division. And the Knollwood maneuvers were a success. Eisenhower saw that, and as a result, the 82nd was maintained as an airborne division, but it could have easily gone the other way. And had the Knollwood maneuvers not been a success, the division, the 82nd, I am certain that the 82nd would be the 82nd Infantry Division today if it had survived. The big, I think, takeaway was that in Sicily, that Ridgway and Gavin demonstrated that they were tough, aggressive, and that they could operate independently, that they could move to the sounds of the guns quickly, and that they could disrupt. And so that had a lot of weight with Eisenhower.
What had changed in the training circular that had they just what are they just sort of tightened up the doctrine which made it a success?
It clarified the application of paratroop glider, troop carrier officers, glider and transport pilots, so it included a lot more things that hadn't been in the earlier doctrine. The previous doctrine was training memorandum number 43. That didn't include any training for the pilots. It didn't include any training for the gunners at sea. All the things that we saw went wrong in Sicily. So it was just a more robust address of all the things that are involved in large-scale airborne operations. And to your point about the Knollwood maneuvers, there's become this sense that this was a rehearsal for D-Day, and that's not the case. This was do or die for the airborne divisions.
I just have a feeling somewhere in the back of my mind that they were allowed to siphon off what were perceived to be better troops into the airborne, better recruits, maybe stronger, fitter, more intelligent. Am I right in that, or have I picked that out from somewhere else?
No, that's true.
More selective.
That is true. I mean, first of all, you had to volunteer to be airborne. The 82nd was actually split down the middle on Camp Claiborne, Louisiana, when the decision was made that they'd become airborne. They were split down the middle. Half would go to the 82nd, half would go to the 101st, and then the 82nd had to draw, you know, they had to fill the shortages from, you know, the conscripted army or from volunteers. And so you had to volunteer to be in the airborne, and then you had to pass the, to pass the airborne school. So in that sense, that was a test above being a soldier.
Surely there was an argument at the end, if you were looking to break them up or convert them, would be, you know, you've got a super elite unit then if you've got, the volunteers, you know, the better class of the volunteers. You kind of got a super elite unit. You could possibly even look to break them up and scatter them throughout, bringing up the rest of the infantry. Or is that never came into the equation?
Yeah, I think this was initially just a math problem for the War Department. Was we were running out of soldiers. We have these soldiers committed to this capability. Is this a wise decision to continue? Many of the same questions are asked today. Do we need this capability? Why do we retain this capability at a division size? Is it worth it? Does it still make sense to go into, you know, with all of the you know, with all the air defense equipment that is out there in the world, does it still make sense? And, you know, if you need to get a force in, it's too late to make something. It's too late to make an airborne division. You've got to have this thing ready and trained. So, you know, that's the other thing. I think I told you this, is that I tell people is that, you know, we have paratroopers that have like 100 jumps, 120 jumps, and then, you know, they're just training to do it in combat. They've never done it in combat. But the jump in Sicily was Gavin's fifth jump. And for a lot of these guys, it was – I mean, they were all in single digits. For a lot of these guys, it was their fourth. Some people, it was their eighth. But they hadn't done this a lot in training.
You're jumping out of a plane at night. You're jumping out of a plane over somewhere that you don't quite know what's below you. You might not be jumping out at the right correct height, so the ground might be on you faster than you expect. And it's your fourth, fifth jump. It's no wonder there was so many injuries.
So the wind – and plus the winds were – you know, you're looking at 30-knot winds and above – and here, I think on Fort Bragg, I think the standard is like 12 knots. You can't jump above 12 knots. That's an incredible wind for that kind of material.
I wonder why they never called it off, or if they just it was just not thought. Yeah.
Well, no, I just think that it was understood that there were going to be a lot of casualties, and if this worked, it worked. You know, that's in it's in one of the books, one of the Eisenhower books that. Eisenhower's notion was this may not work. All these airborne paratroopers will get killed, but it'll certainly be a distraction type thing.
Is there anything that they learned from the back of, well, really the Second World War experience of these jumps that has been carried on into today's training?
Oh, you know, well, the LGOPS concept, little groups of paratroopers, that's something that is in our DNA. That's something that we have to be able to do, and that we did.
How does that work?
Just the idea of disciplined initiative. So you get to the drop zone, you establish link up with your other paratroopers, and you have a general understanding of your objectives. You have your understanding of your objectives, and then you accomplish your objectives. So if you think about a traditional military force, things are always very regimented, and you've got you know, Patton out front pointing out where to go, and you've got General Terry De La Mesa giving orders. That's not the case with an airborne force. You know, you've got to be able to make decisions at the lowest level, and that is unique. That's unique. That was always unique to the 82nd Airborne Division.
Was there anything else that came out that sort of carried across?
I think it's not really fully understood how contentious this was, though, coming out of Sicily, that there was a real move to make the 82nd a standard infantry division and not an airborne division. There was a notion in the War Department that it didn't make any sense to have a full division of airborne capability. In October 1943, the War Department published a training circular 113, Employment of Airborne and Troop Carrier Forces, which described in a little bit greater detail the procedures for planning, coordination, execution, and really the coordination between the air and the sea as paratroopers were en route. The discussion after that, if that was published, was, are these a strategic asset, like in Market Garden, or are they a tactical asset, like in Normandy? How do we use these forces? And I think, like I said at the top, that argument was never fully solved. Other than to say that, you know, there was a wide range of ways that you can employ this division, and as there are now, as you know, that's still true now. You can use the 82nd in something like Haiti, where you can, you know, humanitarian assistance, where you can get something in very quickly, or in Katrina, you know, you have this division that has this airborne capability, and they're ready all the time because they have the airborne capability, so they can do an air land and go in somewhere and do a humanitarian assistance or support to civil authorities. Or obviously, you know, full-scale combat like in Panama, where you can put a force in within 18 hours and begin a high-intensity conflict.
Joe, I think we'll leave it there. Thank you.
So that was my conversation with Angus Wallace about Operation Husky. And in closing this out, I'm out here in Sicily drop zone on Fort Bragg right now to close this thing out. It's March 7th, 2017. It's the middle of the day. There's no one out here. You know, when I look out on the drop zone, it's an empty drop zone right now. I think about all of the safety procedures we have and all of the training and all the knowledge about how to do airborne operations that we have in the 82nd Airborne Division now. And I realized we did not have that. Our paratroopers did not have that back then. This was an incredibly dangerous endeavor, and no one really knew if it was going to work. I hope that people listening to this understand that from this episode. And our paratroopers did it anyway. And, you know, there's a real personality in the division and in the 505th that lives in the 82nd right now. And, you know, we honor our forebears when we live that personality, when we live that courage. I just want to close one thing out here, just close this out with this. This is a quote from Edwin Sayre. Edwin Sayre commanded Alpha Company 505th. He earned a Distinguished Service Cross from Operation Husky. And this is from his memoirs of Operation Husky. Regardless of anything that may go wrong on an operation, if the small unit commander knows his job, his missions, and the missions of other units in the operation, and has the physical and mental courage to try to accomplish the mission, regardless of the obstacles that may confront him, the overall operation will be a success. So that really is disciplined initiative, the idea of little groups of paratroopers, and the idea of personal courage. You know, that really does live in the division today. So I hope you enjoyed this episode. It was a little bit longer, but you know, I hope everybody enjoyed it. And thanks for listening. Airborne all the way.